Hey, good morning, everyone. I'm Rick O'Connor. I'm the Florida Sea Grant agent in Escambia County at the Escambia County Extension Office. And this is Nick Simmons, who is our county director and also our ag and livestock agent. We're going to do a series of videos on invasive plants and animals that you can find in the western part of the Florida Panhandle. And we're going to start this series off with one of the 10 most noxious weeds in the United States, Cogongrass. And as you can see right now, the seed heads are opening up. This is a good time to go out and see if you have it on your property. We are doing this video in April. We're in mid-April right now. So this is a good time to go out and see the plant. And when we talk about invasives, we're talking about plants that have basically three characteristics. Number one, they're from some other part of the planet or some other part of the world, and it got here by human beings. It was either intentional or accidental, but it was humans that got it here. It didn't get here naturally. And the third thing, it's causing a problem. So if you look at this right here, this plant is from South America. What we know is that it first arrived in the early part of the 20th century accidentally. This was an accidental release into the port of Mobile, Alabama. There are some papers that suggest that after that, in the 20s and 30s, it was actually intentionally released as a forage crop in some parts of Florida. So that's how it got here. It is not native. It was brought here by humans, so that deems it as the two of the three strikes as far as an invasive. And then we start talking about the problem. So Nick, you guys are having lots of problems. This is in the ag areas. Let's talk a little bit about the issues with this thing.
Yeah, Rick, it's certainly one of those things that it's a plant that is out of place. You know, some people might call that a weed, obviously. This in the pasture setting, especially with our livestock producers, it's a forage that has little to no nutritional value. So it's not something that we really want to have in a grazing system for our livestock. But because of how it propagates, and you know, you see the seeds here, it spreads very easily with the wind with those very lightweight seeds. What we see is it will start creeping into a pasture setting, and it is highly competitive. And so that's the big issue there, is it outcompetes our desired forages. Here in the Panhandle of Florida, most of our forage systems are a bahia grass system, and this will just simply outcompete it. You can see it grows here in almost kind of a circular pattern. So once you start seeing it, maybe on a fence line or even out in the middle of a field, you know, could be birds that moved it. It will just start growing and growing and growing, and it's something cows, small ruminants, usually will not eat it because of the structure of the leaf. And again, it's just an undesirable. There's no nutritional value, and when it comes in and is out competing what you work hard to grow, then that's where the problem comes in.
Yeah, so you're going to basically lose your pasture land, right, if you don't get onto it. What is it about the leaf that the livestock doesn't like?
So on the leaf structure there, you got one there.
Yeah.
Once it gets roughly to, you know, about 4 to 6 inches tall, it will start getting a serrated edge, almost.
Yeah, I can feel it.
Rough edge there on that leaf blade. And, you know, that's undesirable. You know, you can think you eat something that's rough in your mouth, you know, you're not, you know,
like so
interested. Yeah. And it just has kind of a bitter taste. So, I mean, there's been studies where they had this in a grazing system and cows just simply would graze around it. You know, grass would be eaten down here and this would just be left. And it's just an undesirable. And like I said, that serrated edge can cut your mouth, you know, can cut the animal's mouth. So that's one of the problems that we see with it.
Okay. Well, I guess one way it can end up on someone's property is through the seeds. It can blow across the highway. Mm-hmm. Any other ways that it may show up that they might want to know ahead of time?
We have seen instances where contaminated equipment, maybe you had a pasture that had it and you did, you know, some type of maintenance, some type of tillage, say a disc or you know, some type of plow, and it can, some of the rhizomes under the ground or even some of these seeds, especially if you were doing something at this time when you have seed head, can get affixed to your equipment. You take that to another location. Well, now you're basically inoculating your field with this plant. And so we highly encourage people to be cautious using equipment. You know, if they're doing some maintenance, even bush hogging, obviously, would be a big point of topic. So clean your equipment. If you're working in a contaminated field, you know, wash your equipment off really, really well before you move to another site, and just be cautious. Try to stay out of these areas where it's at.
And I would say, like what I've heard and read also, is at this stage of the game, when it's in seed, that you may not, even now you know it, you see it,
right?
You know, I've got it, but you might want to hold off until this is gone before you start trying to mess with it.
Right, yeah, so certainly, you know, as you can see, it's got these very light, feathery, almost like a dandelion.
Yeah, that's kind of what I think of too.
A vertical dandelion, yeah. Very easy to bust those seed heads open. The wind can carry it. They can stick to your equipment, can stick to our clothes, so we'll need to be cautious with that as well. Yeah, right now is a time, just leave it alone. Really, we recommend people to treat, you know, if they're going to go to a treatment option, wait till the fall.
Okay.
You know, before we get close to that dormant time, we'll do some control at that point. And then if we see a green up early the next spring, then you come back with your kind of your second round of control.
Okay. All right, so we now know, and I will let folks know who are watching this from the Sea Grant side, it is now popping up on our barrier islands. We had a report about 2 years ago on Perdido Key that Cogongrass was growing there. We just did a survey during our annual weed wrangle on Pensacola Beach. We found 6 sites on Pensacola Beach, and it's easy to spot if you're watching now. This time again, April, it's easy to spot. You just ride around on a bicycle or something around the beach, and you'll see these heads sticking up, these seed heads, so you know you've got it there. We're not 100% sure of what kind of impact it has down there on the dunes, but it has become very dense on the west end of Dolphin Island, and our colleagues in Alabama said, hey man, you need to, if you don't have a lot of it, you need to get rid of it as quickly as possible. So that's kind of our plan of attack right now, is to educate the homeowners on the beaches that if this pops up in your lawn, now's the time to do it. You don't want a whole field full of this and then trying to figure out how to go from there. So I guess the next thing we want to talk about is how to identify it. So how would they know, other than the seed head? What other characteristics do we have of this plant?
We've got a sample here. I can pull it up. Some of the main characteristics, obviously, like Rick mentioned, are these seed heads that you'll see this time of year. It's a kind of a burgundy stem, the vertical stem that comes up to the seed head, and very light, wispy, almost like a cattail or a dandelion look to it. So that this time of year, that's very identifiable. Some of the other ways to identify is the leaf structure. You might find one here. Like we said, it has the serrated blades on the edge. So if you run your hand or your fingers along that edge, it feels rough, almost kind of like Velcro or something like that. You can tell that. Most leaves, most of our grass species have a center midrib, a kind of a hard center of it, you know, where the leaf grows out from that center midrib. This one actually has an offset midrib, so it'll be more proportionately, almost like on a third to one side or the other. So that when you don't have seed heads like this, and it's not as easy to see, if you pick up the blade, you can see that midrib is off just slightly. Color is
I was going to say the color way. Of this, well, once the seed is gone, it's got kind of a lime yellow green color.
Yes.
I also found one seed head that's kind of opening up a little bit, so you know, a week or so. How long? These don't last long, right?
Yeah, we'll see in the next several weeks. These seed heads, the stems will start dying off. They'll open up a little bit more. You know, the seed heads will start, the seeds will start spreading a little bit, and then you'll see that those vertical seed head structures kind of die off, and then you'll just have the vegetative. It'll just go into, you know, it's in a reproductive stage at this point, and then it'll just go into a vegetative stage as we get on into the summer. You know, one of the things, it can take our temperatures, the subtropical temperature, it does just fine. You know, stubble height, they'll get, you know, you can see it on roadsides, it could be up to, you know, 30 inches tall, and more of the field pasture setting, we may be more in that 20 to 24 inch stubble height. And the color of it is different, like you said. It's got more of a lime green, lighter green than most of our native plant grasses. We have more of that darker green.
You want to show them those rhizomes? Those things are pretty amazing, too.
Yeah, one of the main things...
actually pierced a piece of bark.
yeah. So one of the interesting things here is how this grows is it has rhizomes that grow underground. And as you can see right here, these are what travel underground, and these will be, you know, on a newly established. You know, these will be about 4 to 6 inches under the ground, traveling under the ground. They can get deeper or really established. I mean, they can get 10, 12 inches, these rhizomes. So this is how it moves, almost in a circular pattern, because these rhizomes are going to move under the ground, new vegetation is going to pop up, and it'll continue to grow. This one actually I've pulled right here. And you can see how aggressive it is. It actually pierced that piece of bark that was actually under the ground when I dug this sample up. And so, I mean, that's very sharp. So it's aggressively growing underground. And so this makes it one of the things for control. You have the vegetation up top, but then you've got these rhizomes that are running under the ground.
Right.
And so that makes it tricky on how you manage the control of it.
And part of the issue problem is also they're liliopathic, so they kind of compete, like you said, they're competing and taking care of neighboring plants and then spread. And that's the other thing, is they kind of spreads in a circle. That's another way to kind of, you'll start noticing these patches. And I also noticed the leaves are dense in the patch. There's a lot of stems per square foot. So real thick patches.
Almost has a bunch grass.
Yeah. All right, so now we know it's a problem. We know what it looks like. We know how to identify it. What do we do? How do we get rid of it?
Yeah, so it kind of depends on the scenario. Like we said earlier, you've got forest landowners that are kind of limited because if they're managing the timber, they have to rely almost like a burn or some disking. Disking is one way to bust up those rhizomes and you start tearing up the growth structure of that and start choking it out. The problem with that is you can get some contamination and move it off site.
Okay.
The other option is to do a burn, where you do a complete pasture burn, and you can work with some local clients or people that do that for you, and do that in the fall as we get closer to that dormancy. You'll do a good burn there. The only drawback with doing a burn is that you usually will get a good lush up the next growing cycle, but that's the time when you would come back with a chemical control. Chemical control is what we recommend more often than not, especially in a pasture setting. A non-selective herbicide such as glyphosate is very effective at killing it. You know, it's going to kill the vegetation. It doesn't have any kind of soil activity to it, so it's going to kill this the vegetation that's above ground. Kind of with that, and we talked about the rhizomes, is that you almost have to choke out. You have to kill that energy, and so you may have to do multiple rounds of spraying before you ultimately dry out those rhizomes, if you will.
That's what I've heard. It may take a couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's not going to be a one and done.
Yeah, I tell a lot of clients that come in, they're asking about control, and I said, at first you're going to manage it. You may not can control it, but you can manage it in the early stages. From there on out, as you get it less and less, then you can control it. Because if you have a small patch of it's fairly easy to manage.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, I will let the folks who are watching who live down on the coastal side that are popping up on the barrier islands, that's a little bit trickier in that there's a lot of plants in the dune systems that are protected. In some of the islands, like in our case, Perdido Key, there's the Perdido Key beach mouse. And you can't do anything really to alter or change the habitat of this federally protected animal. So, we're recommending spot sprays, same kind of thing. Do it in the fall. You see it now, flag it in your yard so you'll know where it is. Don't mow it right now. Come back in the fall with some chemical treatment and just contact us at the extension office. It'll be sort of depends on the site. We probably need to come out to each site and decide, what is going to be the best plan of action on how to treat this stuff. You want to tell us a little bit about your stake there?
Yes, this is, we use this a lot in forage grazing systems. This is, we just call it the grazing stick.
Yeah.
It's a yard stick that's put out through our Natural Resource Conservation Service. They usually have these available. And it has a variety of information, especially if you're trying to manage a forage or pasture system at grazing height or maybe you need to mow. It also has information on mixtures of, number of acres you need and different math equations that you might need. What we like to use it for is just determining what's the standard height of some of these grasses and some of these invasive species? So it always gives us a good reference as we go out and kind of scout fields, just to kind of see, you know, traditionally, you know, your seed head height, you know, like on this stand is roughly 28 to 29 inches. Mm-hmm. And in a pasture setting, this is pretty typical.
Okay.
We see it a little taller on roadside where you see Cogongrass.
Yeah.
Grass height is going to be around that 12 to 14 inch height again, which is pretty common. So it's just a tool that we use when we go out and do some scouting.
Okay. Well, again, if you got any questions about this, if you've got questions about correctly or confirming identification or what best plan of action on how to treat this stuff, contact your local county extension office, whatever county you're in. There's somebody in that office that can help you with this. And Nick and I are going to do some more on other invasive species here in the county. So we'll see you at the next show.